Hello and welcome to video lecture series in Sociology. Today, we are going to discuss from your textbook Social Change and Development in India, Chapter 4, titled as Change and Development in Rural Society. As you know, this chapter is divided into four parts. In the previous lecture on the chapter, we discussed about the features of agrarian society and caste and class in rural India. Today, we will discuss about the land tenure systems and the impact of land reforms. As you know that there is a rough correspondence between caste and class in agrarian structure. This means that usually the upper and the middle caste were the owners of the majority of land and they had best access to land and other resources such as water bodies. They had power, social status, prestige and privilege. Such factors had important implications for rural economy and society. In most regions of the country, certain caste groups own most of the resources and command labor to work for them in the fields. Until recently, practices such as begar or free labor were prevalent in many parts of northern India. Members of lower ranked caste groups had to provide labor for a fixed number of days per year to a village jamindar or landlord. Poverty, lack of education, lack of employment opportunities, and lack of resources meant that the poor, usually, the low caste were dependent upon the landed class for economic, social and political support. In the process, many of the poor laborers got tied to landowners in hereditary labor relationships, that is, the bonded labor. This system is called as Halpati system in Gujarat and Jita system in Karnataka. Although in modern India, such practices have been legally abolished, particularly after independence, yet they continue to exist in many parts of the India. In some villages of northern Bihar, the majority of landowners are Bhumihars, who are also the dominant caste, and a large number of Dalits work as bonded labor with them. The agrarian structure has significantly changed after independence as compared to the pre-colonial and colonial times. But the agrarian social structure somehow continues to remain the same. There are historical reasons why in each region of India, one or two major groups become dominant castes. Let us look at the major land tenure systems in India, namely the Zamindari, Rayatwari and Mahalwari systems, which actually indicate that why certain communities have become dominant in these parts of India. In 1793, Lord Cornwallis introduced the first group of landlords in India by introducing the permanent settlement or the Zamindari system for Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, which was later extended to other parts of northern Madras. By the permanent settlement or the Zamindari system, the Zamindars who were the collectors of the land revenue earlier were made landlords now. They had to make a fixed payment to the government or the East India Company on a periodic basis. The Zamindari system recognized the landlords as the proprietor of the land with the right of inheritance of land. They had the right to transfer, sell or mortgage the land under their possession. But their rights were conditional in nature. A zamindar's right could be withdrawn any time if he failed to pay the fixed revenue on the fixed date to the government. Under zamindari system, both the British and the landlords gained, but the poor cultivating peasants suffered the most. The peasants lost their traditional cultivating rights and became tenants at will. They were left at the mercy of the landlords, who also had their secure share in the production and also owned the land and hence were rich. Since the colonizer also imposed heavy land revenue or taxes on agriculture, the zamindars extracted as much produce or money as they could have done out of the cultivators. One result of this zamindari system was that agricultural production stagnated or declined during much of the period of British rule because the peasants fled from oppressive landlords and also frequent famines and wars decimated the population. The second land tenure system which we will discuss is Rayatwari system. Rayat means the cultivator in Telugu language. The British started individual present proprietorship known as the Rayatwari system in parts of Bombay, Sindh and Madras. This was introduced by Sir Thomas Munro in 1820, the governor of Madras from 1820 to 27. In the Rayatwari system, the actual cultivator was transformed into the owner of the land that he was cultivating. Under this system, the cultivator rather than the zamindar were responsible for paying the taxes. Here the burden of taxation was less and cultivators had more incentive to invest in agriculture because the colonial government dealt directly with the farmers rather than through the landlords. As a result, these areas became relatively more productive and prosperous. In Rayatwari, there was no middleman who mediated between the government and the peasant. The government fixed the revenue directly with the cultivators, but the state's demand was almost half of the production. The revenue was collected by local village officers recognized by the government. But then again, the British never cared about how the rayat or the labor cultivated the land as long as the taxes were paid on time. Unfortunately, the Rayatwari system protected neither the rights of the cultivator nor granted them any concession or financial gain. The cultivators had to pay regular revenue. Failing to do so led to dispossession of their land. The high rate of assessment fixed by the government proved very hard for cultivators many a times. They often suffered oppression and harsh treatment meted by the tax collectors as well. Another type of land system known as Mahalwari or village settlement was introduced in some areas of Awadh, Punjab, Nagpur and Madhya Pradesh. Under the Mahalwari system, the state fixed the revenue for a definite period of 30 years. The settlement of the revenue was made in agreement with the members of the village. Then according to their respective holdings, each peasant contributed to the amount of revenue which the whole village was required to pay to the government. Thus, the peasant remained the owner of the land as long as he could pay his share of revenue. The revenue was fixed according to the type and yielding capacity of the soil, the nature and prices of the crops being produced. However, under all these tenure systems, the burden of tax was borne by the cultivators and they suffered the most. The main motive of the British was to get maximum revenue for the government and the demand of the state kept rising. These systems did lead to changes in agricultural patterns and practices in India, but they favored the rich and the upper caste economically, who traditionally had better access and control over resources. They strengthened the upper caste and weakened the lower castes. One can see a caste class nexus operating in agrarian structure since long time. After independence, the government sought for planned development, focusing upon both the agrarian reform and industrialization. At this time, agricultural sector was in very bad condition. It was marked by low productivity, dependence upon imported food grains, and intense poverty among peasants. A massive agrarian reform was required to remove poverty, stagnation, and exploitation of peasants. The land reforms initiated or introduced by the states focused on 1. Abolition of intermediaries, 2. The settlement of tenancy, and 3. The regulation of size of holdings. Reforms, especially in the land holdings and distribution of land, was necessary at this time to resurrect life in almost dead agricultural sector. Between 1950s and 1970s, a series of land reform laws were passed that were intended to bring about these changes. The first important legislation was abolition of the zamindari system, which removed the intermediaries who stood between the cultivators and the state. Of all the land reform laws passed, this was the most effective law, as it succeeded in taking away the rights of the zamindars over the land and weakened their economic and political power and status. Although initially there was an opposition, as zamindars did not want to part away with their property and social status so easily, but ultimately the law succeeded in strengthening the position of the actual landholders, that is the cultivators. However, abolition of zamindari did not wipe out the landlordism or the tenancy or sharecropping system, which continued in many parts of India. It only removed the top layer of the landlords in the multi-layered agrarian structure, but exploitation of peasants continued in some form or the other. The other major land reforms laws which were introduced were the Tenancy Abolition and Regulation Acts. They attempted to outlaw tenancy altogether or to regulate rents to give some security to the tenants. But in most of the states, these laws were weakly implemented. Yes, in West Bengal and Kerala, there was a radical structuring of agrarian structure that gave land rights to the tenants. But still, the condition of the tenants remained pathetic. In this context, it will be pertinent to discuss about Bhudan movement and Operation Barga. The Bhudan movement was started by Acharya Vinoba Bhave in 1951. Leading the Bhudan movement, Acharya Vinoba Bhave went all over the country on foot with his supporters. The movement involved and appealed for voluntary surrender of the land holdings. Vinoba Bhave's photo appeared on the front page of the Time magazine, recognizing his efforts in the social field. Appealing people to donate their land for good cause, Bhave made a famous statement that "I have come to loot you with love." Surprisingly, 5 million acres of land was given away by big landlords in the movement. But ironically, later it was observed that a lot of this land was infertile or unfit or poor for cultivation. Talking about Operation Barga, it started in West Bengal in 1978. It protected all sharecroppers called as Bargardars by giving them legal protection against eviction from land. It formalized the informal relation of zamindar and the sharecropper and thus prevented exploitation and gave some amount of security to the cultivator or the peasants. The third category of land reform laws were the land ceiling acts. These laws imposed an upper limit on the amount of land that can be owned by a particular family. According to Land Ceiling Act, the state is supposed to identify and take possession of surplus land, that is, above the ceiling limit, held by a household, and later redistribute it to the landless families in other specified categories such as scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Depending upon the kind of land, its productivity and other such factors, the ceiling varies from region to region. Very productive land has a low ceiling, while unproductive dry land had a higher ceiling limit. But in most of the states, this act proved to be ineffective as people found out strategies to manipulate the system and escaped from having their surplus land taken over by the state. These loopholes made the entire exercise unproductive. There were many surprising ways in which landlords contrived to save their land. In most cases, landlords managed to divide the land among relatives and family members, including servants, in the so-called Benami transfers, which allowed them to keep land under their control. In some places, some rich farmers actually divorced their wives on paper but continued to live with them in order to avoid the provisions of the Land Ceiling Act, which allowed a separate share for the unmarried women but not for the wives. So, through divorce, they showed property as divided between them, where wife was on papers owner of the land and not dependent upon the husband. In sum, the success and effectiveness of the land reforms has been uneven across the states in India. The nature of agrarian structure varies greatly across different regions. Although major changes have taken place in rural social structure from colonial times to present times, yet the agrarian structure demonstrates the hold of dominant and land-owning castes. It remains highly unequal. Given the fact that 2/3 of India's population lives in rural areas and is dependent upon agricultural and allied activities, land reforms are necessary not only to boost agricultural productivity, but to eradicate poverty and ensure social justice to all the people prescribed by the Constitution of India. To conclude, let us summarize what we discussed today. We discussed about major land tenure systems, namely the zamindari, rayatwari and mahalwari system. We discussed about the important land reform movements taken up by the government after independence, such as Bhudan movement and Operation Barga, Land Ceiling Act, and we discussed their effectiveness. In the next part of this chapter, we'll discuss about the Green Revolution. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.